This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. My guest for today's show is my friend, Cory Pinegar, and we're going to talk about a system for reactivating past due hygiene patients. If you're a regular listener to the show, you know that I am passionate about a hygiene-driven practice. And in any practice, patients have a way of drifting away from their regular recall. And we want to do everything we can to keep patients actively engaged in your practice. Cory's going to present some amazing information to successfully reactivate patients that are starting to slip away from your practice. But before we get to that interview, we have another top clinical tip from Dr. Leanne Brady.
For our top clinical tip today, I want to talk about a product that's definitely in my top five favorite things I've learned in the last probably 10 years in my practice. And that's a product that's called Servatec Plus, and it's from Ivoclar Vivadent, and it's a chlorhexidine varnish. So all of us know what chlorhexidine gluconate is, and you also know how much you love it. And I say that jokingly. Because all of us use chlorhexidine, or most people use chlorhexidine. I know there are some debates on that as an antimicrobial in the perio community. But most practices are still using chlorhexidine in some version. And we use it, but we have a love-hate relationship with it. We love it because it's a really great antimicrobial. It really gets rid of tissue inflammation. It reduces pocket depths, you know, especially at a patient who's coming in before you're going to do periotherapy, or, you know, they have some gingivitis. You can really decrease the physical size of the pockets so that you can do a better job at mechanical debridement. But we hate it because it tastes terrible and patients complain about it. It actually alters your taste buds. So not only does it taste bad when you're rinsing with it, but patients tell us that everything they eat tastes bad. And of course, the infamous stain and the fact that it turns everybody's teeth brown. And that is just super no fun to have to deal with. Then you can add to it, of course, the cost of a bottle of a chlorhexidine mouthwash and the fact that we have to actually build it up enough that our patients will go to the drugstore and actually buy it, or we have to dispense it in our offices. And so many people that I run into in dentistry, whether they're dentists or hygienists, do not even know that we actually have a product that is chlorhexidine, but it's in a varnish application. So Servatec Plus is the only one that's for sale in the United States. So I can't give you any other brand names to look at. And it is applied just like fluoride varnish. So you're going to buy it. It's going to be applied in a hygiene operatory at the end of the appointment. It's actually FDA approved for caries control specifically. And it's a phenomenal product. And so I love it because it's got all of the positive benefits of chlorhexidine without any of the negatives. The patient doesn't have to go fill a prescription or remember to rinse with it. We're going to apply it to their teeth at the end of the visit. And just like fluoride varnish, the instructions are easy. We're just going to ask them not to brush or floss or eat something sticky or chewy for 4 hours. So it's going to stay on the teeth. It's actually even nicer than fluoride varnish because it's not sticky and goopy. It's totally thin. It's totally translucent. So patients don't complain about it. They can't see it on their teeth. And it has no flavor. It doesn't alter their taste buds, and it causes no brown stain. So it really is just this phenomenal way to have topical application of chlorhexidine. So I use it in my office for all sorts of things. We use it at the end of hygiene visits for patients at higher caries risk, especially if we already have them exposed to fluoride. So if they're already using a high fluoride toothpaste that we've recommended for them, then we'll use chlorhexidine varnish in their office. So we have two different mechanisms of action. We'll use it for our perio patients because you apply it with a microbrush. And so it's super simple to bend a microbrush and apply Servatec Plus down onto the roots of a tooth, 3 millimeters, 4 millimeters, 5 millimeters under a furcation. So you can do it in an isolated spot. I actually put Servatec Plus around the margins of all of my temporary restorations, especially in a large aesthetic case like veneers, so that it really keeps the gums healthy while the patient's in those provisionals, so that we don't have to deal with the gingival inflammation when we go into bond in their permanent restorations. So Servatec Plus from Ivoclar, it's a chlorhexidine varnish, phenomenal product. The science on it is really strong. It's physically on the teeth for about 4 hours, and then the patient will brush it off the next time they brush their teeth. But the studies, most of which have come out of Europe, show it actually reduces the number of bacteria in the mouth for up to as much as 4 to 6 months. So it's a phenomenal product. So it'll give you something you can think about when you're back in your practice, whether it's a hygiene application and adding it to your hygiene regimen, or you're going to use it in your restorative operatories around provisionals to make bonding and cementation more predictable.
Wasn't that another great clinical tip from Dr. Leanne Brady? Before we get to our interview, I want to talk a little bit about our upcoming digital course titled Busting Loose from Insurance Dependence. You know, when I talk to dentists all over the country, I hear that the most pressing concern is third-party intrusion and how participating with PPOs is radically affecting doctors' profitability. I wanted to be part of the solution. So I put together this digital course called Busting Loose from Insurance Dependence as a way for you to regain control of your fees. You know, of all the decisions that Paul and I have made in our leadership of our practice, LifeSmiles, the most important decision we have made was to break loose from insurance dependence and develop a model where we've successfully been able to go out of network, and this has radically improved our profitability. You know, here's what I want you to think of. Recently, I received an email from a dentist saying that last year he had over $500,000 in insurance PPO write-offs, over $500,000. From this moment forward, I want you to think of those insurance adjustments as a marketing expense. Now, why would that be a marketing expense? Because you are paying the insurance company to provide you patients. Does that make sense? Well, the only honest answer to that is it depends. What I'd encourage you to do is to compare your cost of those adjustments with the cost of developing a comprehensive marketing plan. You may discover that it's significantly less expensive for you to develop your own comprehensive marketing plan and get the added benefits of patients choosing you for reasons other than you're on their plan. That was our case, and we have been able to successfully break free from insurance dependence, and I'm going to help you do the very same thing. Here's some things that we're going to cover in that digital course. A specific 7-point plan to successfully go out of network with PPO plans. How to develop a comprehensive marketing plan to consistently attract quality new patients. Comprehensive verbal skills for you and your team members. In particular, verbal skills on how to answer that question, do you accept my insurance? How to reduce your insurance dependency yet remain patient-friendly in the process? How to evaluate your readiness to bust loose from insurance dependence? That's a very important topic. A lot of things need to be in place, and you need to be able to evaluate your readiness to bust loose from insurance dependence. We'll talk about how to master payment options so patients can afford the very best care. We'll talk about the benefits of an in-office patient membership plan and how to use this plan to attract a universe of patients who do not have dental insurance. Finally, we'll talk about how to retain as many existing patients as possible when you go out of network. I want to encourage you to come join us for that digital course, Busting Loose from Insurance Dependence. It starts on Tuesday, June 5th. Don't worry, you don't have to be there when it starts. All of the information is available 24/7, 365. To get more information, visit thrivingdentist.com/free, F-R-E-E. thrivingdentist.com/free. And you can register for that course and get more information about our digital course, Busting Loose from Insurance Dependence. Now on to this week's interview. I mentioned earlier that my guest on this Thriving Dentist Show is my friend, Cory Pinegar. Hey, Cory, how are you?
Gary, thanks for having me on today.
Man, I am so excited about not only having you on, but the topic. We're going to talk about the value of past due hygiene patients. That's one of my favorite topics, and I think it's something you know a little bit about as well.
It's an amazing topic because I think within dentistry, hygiene is known to be important. But when we, you know, go into later today and we talk about the value and the statistics really behind hygiene, it will blow everybody out of the water.
Well, let me credential you first, just in case our listeners don't know who you are. They may know who you are, but if they don't, let me take a minute and credential you. You are one of dentistry's bright rising stars. So we had the opportunity to spend some time together this past weekend down in Orlando, and you hail from Utah, outside of Salt Lake City, Utah. And you're the CEO and co-founder of a company called Callforce. And we'll talk more about that later. But Cory, before we dive into our content, would you do our listeners a favor and share a little bit of your backstory and maybe how you came to find this amazing profession of dentistry?
Yes. Well, I will be honest with everybody that I found this purely by accident. So I actually was attending Brigham Young University probably my sophomore year, and I got a job at Weave Communications. And I worked there for over 2 years. And then me and my co-founder and I, actually a little over a year and a half ago, had the opportunity to purchase a division from Weave Communications. And it was their live recall division, which Callforce is today. We rebranded it. And so I fell into dentistry on accident and then just have fallen in love with it. And fallen in love with the ability to make differences in people's practices and help them see results and help us see results as well.
Well, our listeners, of course, will recognize the name Weave because recently I had their CEO and founder, Brandon Rodman, on the show. So he was on the show recently talking about some of the cool things that are happening with telephone technology. So kind of coincidence that here you are with some history with Weave as well.
It is. It's amazing. And Gary, you know this. In Utah, there is just a plethora of dental technology companies. It's kind of the mecca of startups for dental right now.
Well, you know, right there in Lehi, where you're not far from that, you're actually located in, is yours a Provo address?
Yes.
Yeah, you're in Provo, which is a little bit farther down the valley. But if we go maybe 15 minutes north of you to the little town of Lehi, it is an area that is absolutely booming with not only technology companies, but dental technology companies. In fact, I shared in the Weave interview that the area where Brandon's office is, we all know the reference to Silicon Valley, of course. That area has been earned a nickname called Silicon Slopes, because of the proximity to some great skiing, right?
Exactly. It is unreal. If you drive along that corridor right now, they are building buildings faster than you can possibly imagine.
I think it started with Adobe as one of the earlier big technology companies there. Was that kind of like the genesis of that area there when Adobe located there? And now there's many, and many, many dental companies are there. You know, in the general area right there, you know, I think of Weave, I think of Solution Reach. I think of my awesome friend, Weston Lunsford and Dental Intel, my friend, Jack Hadley, with, my social practice, of course, Dentrix, you know, isn't far from there. And on the supply, on the more of the material side, right, 15 minutes away, is Ultradent, Dan Fisher and Ultradent. Of course, we've got Gordon Christensen and CRA, you know, nearby as well.
Curve has their center. Curve has their support team in Utah as well.
Curve as well. So many companies located right there. So you're kind of at the hub of dental technology support companies are all right there.
It's awesome.
You know, interestingly enough, Cory, I learned the value of the hygiene department from my earliest days in this profession. I started in 1980. And that's before you were born. So go ahead, say it.
I'm 24 years old.
Okay, that's way before you were born. And that's okay because we need these sharp young guns to keep us you know, to keep up with. We got to keep up with you guys. But I started in 1980, and I was very fortunate to have a mentor, Dr. Omer Reed. And Omer taught me that the hygiene department is the backbone of a successful general dental practice. So as you're listening to this, by the way, Cory, we have listeners in 162 countries. Kind of cool about that. And as you're listening to this, doctors, I want you to get your arms around that. If you don't already believe that hygiene is the backbone of a successful practice, hopefully Cory and I can convince you of that. I believe you were on the same page, Cory, right?
Oh, and I can even dive into just right off the bat, if that's okay, Gary.
Go for it.
Just to help people realize how much of their how many hygiene patients are overdue. So we sat down with a large group practice, multi-million number of patients. Okay. And we looked and we ran a report and we said, okay, out of your active patients, how many are overdue? What do you think, Gary? What's kind of a guess you
can
give us?
Well, it'd be interesting to compare and contrast the perception of what's going on in the practice and the reality of it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, I'm a little bit privy to this conversation because you and I spent some fun time talking about this last weekend in Orlando. So I feel like I have the key to the exam. You know, you've given me the key.
That is true.
But if I didn't have that conversation with you, my comment would be what doctor thinks is going on in terms of activation and current patients in his practice or her practice is probably very different than the reality.
Absolutely.
So doctor might say, yeah, Cory, you know what? I've got a really good team and they work really hard. We pre-appoint our hygiene and yeah, we have some slip through the cracks, but I'll bet 80% of our patients are actively involved in our recare. And by the way, Cory, I use the term recare instead of recall. Recall is something Detroit does to bad cars.
No, that is a good vocab change as well.
So, I mean, we could use that term recall between us because we know what it means, but I like to use the term recare. And, you know, most dentists, I believe, would answer the question this way. Cory, we do a really good job with that. And sure, we don't get everyone, but I'll bet we have 80% or more of our patients actively involved in recare in our practice. And what would be the reality?
So people that are overdue, percentage of patients overdue is 76%.
Wow. Okay, there's a takeaway. Listen to what Cory said. And by the way, this is not some number you pulled out of the hat. This is hard data.
This is millions of patients across every state in the United States.
You know, I know this to be true because when our team reactivates patients, and let's say hypothetically you were a patient of ours,
mm-hmm.
and Carly would contact you and she might say, Cory, and by the way, we might have also contacted you by text message and email, but we also do some calling and we'll explain why that's important as well. And she might finally reach you and she might say, you know, Cory, this is Carly calling from LifeSmiles Dental Care. And, you know, we care about our patients. And I realized as I was looking at your records that it's been a little while since we've seen you. I wanted to call and make your appointment. And the patient might say, oh, I was just there. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And Carly would say, no, I actually looked at my records and it's actually been 15 months since your last visit. What do you think the natural reaction is from the patient when assuming that was the case? What do you think most people would say?
Oh, wow. Most people are blown away and most people are willing to get right back on the schedule too.
And maybe in a little bit of denial, like, no way.
It's not been that long.
And then we, you know, politely, we don't rub their nose in it at all, but we'll say, no, I see that it was, you know, here we are in May of 2018. No, your last visit was actually in January of 2017. And then all of a sudden it's like, oh my gosh, it was right after the new year. I remember, oh my gosh, I had no idea. Mm-hmm. And I believe that if you,
and to dive,
go ahead.
And to dive in, and I'll let you go in just a second, or you can go first, Gary, but to dive in a little deeper, just to even cement the fact of 76% of patients are overdue, if we go back 18 months or more, of those patients, 56% are still overdue.
Wow.
And so we are just dealing with so much potential. And that's why it's so informative is we're going to talk about the value of bringing these people back in, but also know we are just sitting on mounds and mounds of gold in the backs of our offices.
So I want to use an analogy. Obviously, this is audio, our format. But what this discussion is all about is about low-hanging fruit. You don't even need to get the ladder out. It's there for you, doctors. It's there. And if you want to build your practice, this is the quickest way to build your practice. A strong hygiene department is a natural feeder into a strong practice because we're it does so many things. We keep our patients healthier. We reduce their future dental expenses because we're taking care of things in advance. And it's a flat out practice builder because the more hygiene patients you have, the more exams you get to do and the more restorative dentistry that shows up on your schedule. I mean, it sounds obvious, but would you echo those sentiments?
Oh, absolutely. So one out of every six patients that is seen by our doctors is getting additional work done. Now, if we even focused more on case acceptance, Gary, that number would go up from there. But right now, for every patient we're bringing back in, we're seeing over $500 in created revenue from that appointment.
Wow. And you know, I'm going to be critical for just a minute. And the part I'm going to be critical on is that many dentists, and I'm lecturing pretty much every Friday somewhere, just like I was with you last weekend out in Orlando. And dentists come up to me at the break and they'll talk to me about what's going on in their practice and what they could use some help on. And they want some recommendations from me. And very often dentists will have more focus on new patients. If I just had more new patients, my practice would be ideal. If I just had more new patients, it's somehow not very sexy and exciting to reactivate patients, but they want more new patients. And I don't disagree on the need for a steady flow of new patients. That's absolutely true. But let's also make sure that we have the back door closed as well, so we're retaining as many of our patients as we can. And I know that's your mantra as well, right?
Exactly. And to echo what you said even more, Gary, is recare is so important. I was making sure I didn't say recall there.
Right. You caught yourself.
I'm not going back to Detroit.
Right.
But recare is so important because the dentist and the hygienist and the office manager have built rapport with these patients.
They know you, like you, and trust you. Right. Those people know you, like you, and trust you. And yet they've strayed oftentimes just kind of just no fault. In other words, they didn't realize it had been that long since their last visit.
Mm-hmm. And Gary, we make millions of calls. And oftentimes I will meet with dentists and they will sit there and they say, okay, well, how is your staff trained for crowns and implants and SRP and perio and, you know, all of these more in-depth, you know, explanation processes. And to be honest, we've made millions of calls and reviewed the data from that. And most people realize I'm overdue and I probably should get back on the schedule. Most people don't say, you're going to have to convince me today why I should come back to your office. When people have preventative insurance, and if they do, and you say, you know what, you have two preventative cleanings this year, Gary, we'd love to get you back on the schedule. People say, why not? I'm already paying for this, so I should get back on the schedule. It's not this sales process, but we are just inviting them and giving them an open slot on the schedule to schedule in.
Right. So let's take a deep dive into this. And I want to ask you a very direct question. I know you have data on this. What is the real value of overdue patient recare? What's the value?
Well, instead of just laying out some numbers on the table, I'm actually going to share some stories of offices that we work with. So we work with offices around the United States and Canada, and we reactivate the patients for them. And so there's an office in Indiana, and we, over the last 8.5 months, have reactivated 329 patients for them.
So 329 patients, that's a nice subset of people that were drifting away.
Mm-hmm. And we're averaging still about 40 a month, 40 reactivated a month, patients a month still.
So that number is just going north.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that number just increases by a number of about 40 more every month.
And so we then sat down and we used Weston's technology and we said, okay, what is the production that has come from these 329 appointments so far?
Yeah, pause there for just a second, Cory. I want to give a shout out to Weston and to Dental and Tell. In fact, I'll put a link in the show notes for Dental and Tell. If you're not familiar with Dental and Tell, you need to be. Dental and Tell is a real-time dashboard that rides alongside your practice management software, and it culls information from your practice management software and displays it on a digital dashboard with about 30 different metrics that will allow you to completely know what's going on in your practice in real time at any given time. I literally wouldn't want to practice without Dental and Tell. So I wanted to put that in there since you mentioned it, Cory, but carry on from there.
Yeah. And so we reviewed, you know, what have these 329 patients brought in terms of production so far in 8.5 months, Gary?
Okay.
$192,716 of revenue.
So you see, I knew you had data. It wasn't just round numbers.
Hey, I've got exact numbers. And some people may say, well, my office cannot produce 40 appointments per month. And for some offices, that's true. So let's look at an example of something I pulled last week from Dental and Tell again. And thus, office in Texas, we scheduled 19 appointments for them in the last month. From those 19 appointments already, just 30 days later, $10,883 worth of revenue has been created.
Wow. So I did the math really quick on the 329 patients that were reactivated in your example that had produced $192,716, and that was done in 8.5 months. It's an average of $585 per patient. So clearly, these patients need some restorative dentistry or need some kind of dentistry done in addition to the hygiene appointment to get that kind of a number, to get $585 per patient.
Mm-hmm.
And I can imagine that this is probably fairly representative of what you see, right?
It's consistent across the board.
Wow. So going back to another statistic where you said, you know, 76% of patients are overdue, man, I can't think of a better word to describe this than opportunity.
And I look at it, Gary, you already touched on it. I'm going to touch it again because it's so important. We talk about new patients. That is awesome, but we are sitting on gold. And let me tell you, the cost of reactivating a patient compared to actually bringing in and re-care patient is far less.
Well, it makes sense logically because if it's a new patient, we've yet to develop the full relationship and rapport with them as we have with existing patients. So it might take a little time to percolate that a little bit.
No, exactly. And I look at offices who are bringing in new patients and I say, let's focus on both. And you know what? We work with offices all the time who have to bring in a part-time or a full-time hygienist because they didn't realize how much gold they were sitting on, Gary.
Okay, so let's take a deep dive into this. I know you've got our listeners' interest at this point when we're talking about these numbers and talking about the details. And you have developed some very good training, verbal skills, scripting, that sort of thing. So let's say there's a dentist listening to this and she's thinking, oh, wow, I bet I have more than 329 that are past due in my practice. I've got a team member up front that can help me with this. What scripts have you seen? What verbal communications have you seen that work so that we can help our listeners maybe take some action on this? Now they know it's like, okay, now we've identified the problem. Now, what do I do about it? Well, we're going to start to reactivate them. What scripts have you seen or language? I'd like to use the word language instead of scripts. What kind of language have you seen that works well to reactivate patients?
Great question, Gary. The language that we see, and first of all, the overarching theme of the language is simple and caring. Before anything else, a lot of the time in dentistry, we can overcomplicate that call to the patient initially. That is not where we're diagnosing treatment. That's not where we're presenting cases. It is we're bringing them into the office because we care. And so a script that we consistently use right now is we would say, you know, hello, is this John? Well, this is Corey calling from Dr. Smith's Family Dental Care. How are you doing today? We'd wait for, you know, John to respond. Mm-hmm. The doctor actually asked me to reach out to you today, John, because he or she noticed that you're overdue for your professional hygiene cleaning, and we wanted to get you scheduled for that.
So let's talk about that wasn't a random, you know, you just came up with something out of your hat. There was, that was a very crafted language. Mm-hmm. And you started with asking them how they were. So you're expressing interest. That's intentional, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So we want to be cordial. I mean, want to greet the, you know, greet the caller and ask them how they are. But I like what you said in your first sentence. You said, doctor asked me to call. Talk about the language. Talk about the psychology around that.
When people have a front office manager or a hygiene coordinator call them or an office manager, but when they realize that the doctor noticed they were overdue and he or she wanted to see them, there's a little more weight to the situation. And you realize that the doctor is invested in within your own oral health. And so you feel more responsibility to get in and see the doctor and the hygienist.
I love that. I believe that the recipient of that call will act differently based on the words that you used.
Mm-hmm.
I believe they're more motivated to do something.
And what we notice from there, Gary, is that if we educate people, now this is only if they do have preventative insurance, but if they do and we educate them that they do have two preventative cleanings this year and we want to get them in so that they can use that, people are like, slapping themselves on the forehead a lot of the time, like, oh yeah, let me get scheduled for that.
Well, you know,
we are busy.
You're right about that, Corey. You know, and I think I'll explain what I think is going on and maybe you can add to this. The reality is that your patients don't think about their dental insurance the way we think about it. It's out of sight, out of mind. And by the way, hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars are left on the table every year of unused benefits. If you don't use it, you lose it. They don't carry over. But when you mention to a patient, like we do the, you know, the end of the year insurance letter, we send that out in September and we send that out now digitally, but we say that, you know, Corey, we're going to share a tip with you. The way your insurance works is that it provides a certain benefit each year. Any benefits that you don't use, don't get carried over to the next year. They simply evaporate. If you have any concerns, you may want to get in before the end of the year so we can help you fully utilize your dental benefits. And I can't tell you how many times patients will say, I just forgot completely about that. In other words, they don't give any thought to it at all. They, when you bring it up, their response is, oh yeah, that's how it works, right? Yeah, I remember now. But it took your prompt for them to remember it. Is that what you experience as well?
Exactly. And something to dive in, a slight tangent, but most of our offices are using a patient relationship software, which is a text message and email reminder system, Gary. And those text messages and emails go out pretty frequently. And then sometimes, let's be honest, you get a text message or I get a text message and we say, ooh, that's important, but I've got 18 other things on my plate right now. I'm going to text them back tonight. Mm-hmm. So when we call these patients, a lot of the time they say, oh my goodness, I was going to text you back the other day. You texted me because I was overdue, but I just forgot to text you back. Thank you for calling. People want to be on the schedule. Now, some people don't, we'll be honest, but predominantly people are interested in their oral health when we present them with the opportunity.
My experience has been, I want to be careful about using absolutes like always or never. Absolutes are dangerous statements to use. So I'm gonna phrase it a little bit differently. Most patients really appreciate these calls. I was gonna say everyone appreciates these calls, but probably the better way to say that is most patients genuinely appreciate these calls. Has that been your experience?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's not like you're trying to, it's not salesy. It's really just caring about it. I love the way you framed it. You said that the concept of these calls has to be framed around simple and caring. Simple and caring.
You're absolutely right. And if we focus on those two, patients never feel pestered. They feel that we're genuinely interested. And if they decline that opportunity, we did our part.
So let's amplify this. Let's build on this a little bit. You've talked a little bit about some verbal skills. And I really, would you repeat that again, just for our listeners' benefit, that sample call, because it was perfect. Would you repeat that again?
Yeah. You'd say, hello, is this John? John's going to respond. And you say, hey, this is Megan from Dr. Smith's Family Dental Care. How are you doing today? Of course, wait for him to respond again. And then say, the doctor actually asked me to reach out to you today because he or she noticed that you were overdue for your professional hygiene cleaning, and we wanted to get you scheduled for that.
Man, if you're listening to this, hit rewind and write that down because it's good. It's good. You know, if you're listening on your iPhone or your if you're an Android person, you listened on probably your Samsung phone, you can hit the rewind and go back 15 seconds, 30 seconds and get that again. But very, very, very good verbal skills. So let's amplify that. What techniques, in addition to, you know, that kind of scripting, that kind of verbal skills, what techniques will make the overdue patient calls most effective?
Perfect. We're going to get into some really hard techniques in a second. This is kind of a bridge between the call and techniques. Mm-hmm. Something besides that verbiage right there, the second biggest effector of actually them scheduling is the tone of the caller's voice. And so if we get them on the phone and we say, hey, John, you know, we noticed you're overdue for your professional hygiene cleaning and the doctor wanted to get you scheduled for that. No, that's not that effective. But when we are engaged and we have a slightly higher tone to our voice of genuineness, mm-hmm. the call goes completely different. So it's just not the language of the call, but it is the tone of the voice that the call is being made from.
Can I amplify that concept for a minute, Cory?
Absolutely.
So I know from studying linguistics and studying the field of communication that only 7% of a message is the words. 93% is everything else. Everything from tone of voice, volume, pacing, inflection, pregnant pauses. If we're face-to-face, things like, you know, eye movement. All of that can communicate, can make the total communication. Only 7% of that is the words. Cory, we didn't talk about this ahead of time, but could I go ahead and role play this with you as an example for our listeners?
Of course.
I'm going to say two phrases, and I'm going to say the exact same words, and I'm going to suggest that they have different meaning based on how I say them. May I go ahead and do that?
Go for it.
So here's the first example. Cory, it's great to see you today. Okay, let me use the second example. Cory, it's great to see you today.
The second message one is excited.
Exactly. And so understand that what Corey's talking about here, tone of voice, is critically important. And really, what I'm going to suggest you want in that tone of voice is caring, that we care about the person on the other end of the call. And the care, I believe, can be felt through the tone of voice.
Exactly. And that when we look at our schedulers within our office, it's the tone of voice that separates them.
So let's go down this path. Let's get in the weeds about techniques here to make, in addition to, you know, the scripting and the words, let's go a little deeper in it and talk about techniques that you've found that make this work really well.
Well, number one, right off the bat, is later in the day is more effective. When dental offices are making calls during the day, Gary, it's taking them on average 21.4 calls to schedule one overdue patient. Because on average, we're getting 90% voicemails.
21.4 calls. And was that 21.4 to reach someone or to successfully reappoint him?
Successfully reappoint them.
Okay. So that makes me think that this can be very frustrating. In other words, a lot of activity to produce a result. And I can imagine that people get frustrated in the process.
Exactly. And that's why consistently we see ReCare falling on the back burner, Gary. We know it's important, but it's a frustrating, tedious process that we push off sometimes because, to be honest, we don't want to do it.
You know, I'll be real honest with you on that. I bet I've been in over 2,200 practices as a coach over the years. I could probably count on one hand, and I'm not exaggerating, I could probably count on one hand the number of team members that I've met that were flat out excited about doing this.
I could echo that as well.
It's just an observation.
Exactly. And so what we recommend for a technique is calling from 5 to 7:30 actually makes the practice twice as likely to schedule an overdue patient. Now, not everyone wants to stay till 7:30, but even if we're using the 4:30 to 5:30 mark or the 5 to 5:30 or 5 to 6 o'clock, we're significantly more effective with that call.
So again, I assume you have data on this. So the 5 to 7:30 is supported by data.
Yes. And so when you call during business hours of a day, to a consumer side, you receive 91% voicemails. When a business to consumer calls from 5 to 7:30, you receive 82% voicemails. That may still seem like an enormous amount of voicemails, but we are twice as effective in the calls that are made.
Wow. So obviously be mindful of time and the time of day making the calls.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Excellent. I think you just documented what we've known kind of just experientially, but you've put some meat on the bone in terms of some documentation around it.
Exactly. And next, what we're seeing with techniques is recall, just as you said, it's the backbone of the practice, Gary. It provides a lot of data. And so what we see is when we're making those calls, are we documenting why the patient is unwilling to come in? It's great that the patient is willing to come in, but what about the patients that aren't willing to come in? Are we seeing people don't have rides? Is it consistent bad experiences? Is it most people have moved out of the state? And so what we believe is taking copious notes within the call log gives data to the practice on why people are not coming in, and also allows practices to inactivated needed patients so that they're not calling them again.
Right, right. Assuming for a minute that there weren't any external reasons like they've moved or something like that, I don't imagine that very many patients resist making the appointment using the technique and the methods that you're using. Most people are like, oh yeah, let's do it.
Exactly. Besides that, it's, oh, this is interesting, but I don't know my schedule right now. Can I get back to you?
There you go. I was going to ask you what the most common reason not to pre-appoint would be, and I imagine it's what you just said, not having a good handle on their schedule.
Because we're catching people in the car. We're catching people walking out to the garage to get in the car. We're catching people at work. And so that's the biggest reasoning right there is, let me get back to you.
So let me put you on the spot. So can I put you on the spot?
Of course.
So Cory, I'm the patient you're calling. Oh, hey, thank you so much for my call. I'm literally just getting out of my car right now. I saw that it was you on my caller ID, so I wanted to pick up. I just don't have my calendar in front of me. How would you respond?
So we come from ours is a tougher side to answer there because we don't want to force someone to schedule and then have them cancel on the practice. What we do recommend, if I were the practice, I would offer them our three closest open times. I say I have a Tuesday morning, a Wednesday afternoon, and a Thursday evening or whatever's open, and three spaced out times. If they can accept one of those, then at the end of that call, you end with the promise. And you say, hey, Gary, if actually you can't make that time, will you promise me that you'll call in and let me know that you can't make this appointment? And when people engage in something called the promise, they hold to the appointment significantly more.
I love that.
There's a genuineness of, I told someone, I'd promise them if I can't come in, I'm going to let them know beforehand so we just don't have no shows.
It's almost a cultural moray, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like my grandmother taught me, if you make a promise, you better follow through on it.
Exactly.
Wow. Love it. Love the training that you're doing. So I want to get a little more specific here. many listeners here will have the experience of saying, okay, I now am understanding the importance of reactivation. I think I have a team member that can do this. I'm now going to provide some training. We're going to dive into it. I've often found that offices sort of have mixed results. They'll go after it for a little while and then they'll go off and get distracted on another project. Have you seen that happen as well?
Absolutely. And we see oftentimes, okay, the hygienist has an open 2-hour gap to her schedule. Let's have the hygienist call. Or the office manager for once isn't busy. Let's have her call, or the hygiene coordinator. But what we see to be most effective here, Gary, is when the practice builds a system. And a system isn't when you have time. A system is, okay, 3 1-hour blocks of every week, we will make calls to overdue patients. We will mark notes within the software. We will make them in later hours of the day to be more effective. And we will go 12 weeks and review our results. But unless we build systems of, oh, we're not busy, so we better call, but consistent systems, that's when recall is successful.
You struck a resonant chord with me there, Cory, because I'm such a systems person. I really believe in the power of a systems-driven practice. I'm going to just be real blunt, doctor, if this is something that you're, if reactivating past due hygiene is something that your team member is going to do if they have time, that's not a system. In fact, that's really setting yourself up for failure. Would you agree, Cory?
Oh, absolutely. We talk to hygienists all the time. And what happens, and you know this, Gary, is, okay, the hygienist has an open part of her week. She begins to make calls. Then he or she hits 2 or 3 weeks where hygiene's full. But then out of nowhere, they don't have time to make calls, but they've hit another 3 or 4 days where the schedule is a little shattered.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see that often. You know, in other words, we'll respond to an immediate urgency in the schedule, and then we go back to our old habits. And it's not systematized, it's not consistent, it's not happening on a regular basis.
Exactly.
So let's talk a little bit about what you're doing with Call Force. Can you describe your company and what you do and how you may be a great resource if our clients are not having success doing this on their own?
Yeah. So oftentimes practices come to us when they realize that, you know what, there is 5 hats we're all wearing in each office. And they come to us and they say, we'd love for you to focus on our recall. So just as everything we talked about, we implement within our company, and we would consider ourselves a dental solutions company that is focused on increasing the office's productivity.
Nice.
And so what we do is we'll go into any practice management software, pull that list of your overdue patients. We sort out anyone with a significant balance due, and also sort people so that if there's a head of household, we're not also calling them 3 times for their children, but we're calling the head of household and mentioning their 3 overdue children. From then 5 to 7:30, we'll place those calls for you. And then we will report back to you on who scheduled and also who did not schedule and why they did not schedule. Then you can see and get a feel and a pulse for your practice. And we're providing these notes, or we're providing the appointments straight into the practice management software. And as well, we're providing an electronic report of data each day so they can understand what's happening with our calls. And these calls are actually coming from the practice's actual number, Gary.
And so imagine, I'll tie it back to an example that you used earlier. Doctors, imagine that Corey's team is able to reactivate a patient. And if it was similar to the kind of result that you received in that practice where you reactivated 329 patients, you just added $585 to your production. It wasn't just the value of the hygiene appointment, but it was a value of the restorative dentistry that came along with it.
Exactly. And so typically our practices see, Gary, so to dive into those results, for the 19 appointment office, which produced $10,883 worth of production, they spent $475. For the office that produced $192,716, they spent $8,250 with us.
Wow. I'm doing some quick math so that our doctors can kind of understand that. Just a second. So you actually paid about 4% of the revenue that was derived to get that to happen. 4%.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty good ROI, I would say.
You can put your money in the stock market, or you can do your overdue patient recare.
Yeah, let's stick to what we know, huh?
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about the company. How? What's your head count? What kind of people do you have doing this? I'm kind of being probing because I imagine some of our listeners have these kind of questions.
No, these are great questions. So since we took it over from Weave, we've gone through some aggressive growth. We're over 20 callers right now, or around 20 callers. I don't want to overpromise and underdeliver, but sure. We're growing pretty consistently every week. This week alone, we're going to add about 5 new team members.
Wow.
And we predominantly have female callers who are in their mid-20s so that we can hold the front office feel.
I imagine that there are times where the patient comes into the practice. Give me the name of someone on your team that is a caller. Give me just her first name.
So, you ready for this? This you didn't know. All of our callers represent themselves as Megan on the phone. So if someone calls to the practice and says, "Megan said this," they know it was call force.
Got it. I didn't know that. So I imagine there's times where someone comes in and says, "By the way, I want to meet Megan."
Mm-hmm.
How cool is that, right?
We have had a few practices call us and said, "You worked with a really hard patient who usually chews us out, and you were able to get him on the schedule." And those have been awesome experiences for us.
Wow. That's kind of a cool system that you have set up so that the office has kind of a tracking or an understanding of what happened.
Mm-hmm.
That's cool. I did not know that.
And it allows the practice to really keep their records up to date. And then we look at some practices sometimes and we say, "Wow, we started with 482 overdue patients. And when we run the report now, we're significantly less and we're chipping through that gold that they have."
Man, that is so cool. And, you know, and finally, doctors, you can check off the list. You know, this is one of those things that the team, and I'm not trying to be critical here, but most of the time they just never get around to it. Good intentions. But, and I'm going to come to the defense of the team. There's so many distractions that come up during the day. I understand why it doesn't happen. But what a great way to outsource it, and what a great way to outsource it cost effectively for you.
Yeah. Awesome. And to touch on some other general questions that we get, oftentimes people say, "Well, is some random quote unquote Megan going to be calling for our office?" No, we actually have dedicated people to offices because every office is unique, Gary. You know that. Every office schedules differently, takes different insurances, is open different hours. So you have a dedicated account manager who will sit down and build a doctor profile. So we know all of the general questions that patients could ask. And then when our callers are calling in behalf of your office, they can then schedule them for their favorite hygienist, or if they have a question about how late you're open on Wednesday or different questions along that line, we can adequately answer those questions.
So really doing this with a high level of customer service because of their familiarity with the practice.
Yeah, we don't want to just, you know, slap them down for an hour appointment, but we really want to act as the office would, and we just want to be a generator of patients coming in.
And I heard you say earlier that you really don't push to make that, to schedule the appointment for fear that that patient really isn't committed to it and they might back out. But you still have a very high success rate of getting people to a point without a pushy, brusque kind of approach.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, I love what you're doing, Cory. I love the idea of being able to outsource this. We're going to be putting this in place in our practice at Life Smiles because I have an amazing business team. But guess what one of the things is that's hard for us to get to? Go ahead, Cory. Guess what it is?
Recare.
Yep. And I know how important it is. And we're going to use the power of outsourcing on this. So I can't wait to, we're in the process of getting that set up now in our office and very excited to have your passion and skill around this. Cory, I know that our listeners are going to want to get in touch with you. Would you be kind enough to share your website address so they can reach out to you?
Yeah, it's actually getcallforce.com. So getcallforce.com. And also if people want to reach me personally, Gary, My email is Cory@getcallforce.com, and Cory is C-O-R-Y.
Great. Thanks. There's multiple spellings of Cory. I'm glad you spelled it out.
Most people spell it with an E, so I have to
get
that one out there.
So, hey, if you're driving, don't take your hands off the wheel. I'll put all that information in the show notes. It's getcallforce.com and Cory, C-O-R-Y, at getcallforce.com. But go to thrivingdentist.com, scroll down, you'll see links, and you can go directly there. Now, I want to do something kind of fun here, Cory. I happen to know that you're a pretty decent golfer. Is the rumor mill accurate on that?
I'm an okay golfer.
Well, I think you're understating it, but you're a pretty decent golfer. And you live in the Salt Lake City area, the broader area of Salt Lake, which happens to have some really good golf courses. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to extend an invitation out to our listeners. If you've ever wanted to go to Utah and experience some of their world-class golf courses, you now have a personal guide and host that would be happy to coordinate that for you. So, Cory.
Hey, that's why I gave out my email.
That's right. So if you say, well, I don't know anybody in Utah, now you have a friend in Utah, Cory Pinegar. He'll be happy to coordinate some golf. If you're more of a winter person, he could probably direct you up to the slopes and show you some
powder. I can tumble
powder.
Down the slopes with you guys. I'll be there with the ski patrol.
Hey, there you go. But anyway, my point is you have a friend in Utah, someone who's passionate about dentistry, someone who may be a wonderful resource for you and your practice. Cory, I want to take a minute and thank you for all that you do, man. You are one of dentistry's bright young stars, and I really appreciate your passion, your wisdom, your leadership in that company. You are committed to your client's success, and man, what a great resource for our listeners.
And first of all, thank you, Gary. And the last thing I would say to everyone is we are here to help. I gave out my email truthfully, not for golf, but because if you guys have questions about scripting or techniques or anything that we can help with, reach out. And we just want to help everybody thrive within their community.
Oh, man, I love that spirit. And that's why I wanted to have you on the show. So I know that in your heart, you're about helping people. And I love to include that as a resource on the Thriving Dentist Show. Hey, I want to take a minute and thank our listeners as well. We appreciate each and every one of you. There's three things you can do to support our work. Number one, you can tell a colleague about the podcast. There's many dentists that have not heard the word podcast. Educate them about podcasts and direct them to the Thriving Dentist Show. Second thing that you can do is you can go on iTunes and write us a review. If you haven't done that, I would really encourage you to do that. That helps us a great deal in the same way that, say, a Google review helps you in your practice. The third thing that you can do is you can hit the subscribe button on your podcast directory on iTunes or Google Play or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. When you hit subscribe, it means that every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it automatically uploads to your listening device. You'll never miss a future show. They're all free. This was show number 330. All of our past episodes, all 330 of those, can be downloaded for free on iTunes or Google Play. So if you want to go back and listen to past episodes, you can absolutely do that. On that note, let me thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.